And safe travels to you, madam. Oh, there's Ziobe. An odd lilting song occasionally rises from within this machine as if a musician is trapped inside. Oh, I hear it. Oh, there's Theboros, Ziobe, and Dhama of the Bloom. You must join. Theboros. This man's mind is sealed off from you, like trying to read the thoughts of a book that's been glued shut. The man is old and strong, his face lined with years of brutal experience. His face is aquiline, his nose sharp. He wears a broad-brimmed hat, and his voice is a low rasp.
I'm Theboros, he says. Tell me your story. Make it a good one.
I was born falling from the sky, and now I'm trying to repair a chamber that will stop a nightmare. He watches you intently as you speak. When you finish, he nods sharply. I'm not going to say that voice the whole time. My voice is starting to hurt as it is. So we got Indigo Tide. You're telling the truth, he says. A lot of people embellish, or they lie outright. Try to pretend they're more than they are. That thing. So people will remember them as giants. More often than not, they just end up looking ridiculous. He pats you on the shoulder. You've given me a rare treat. Thanks. So, what do you want? Can't help you with your chamber, but maybe there's something else. Can you tell me about yourself? I'm the brains of this operation. He gestures with a lazy hand around the table. Without me, they'd lose the thread of their thoughts and spend all their time wandering in dreams. Dhama says, we're just trying to get away from your nagging. He tips his friend a wink. It's that nagging that sharpens my word, Dhama. Though I admit that my words are probably getting duller every second I spend talking to you. He turns back to you. Let's call me a warrior of language. Words are my weapons and my treasures. They might be pretty sounds to you, but to me, they're the tools that pry open your imagination and leave you vulnerable to my friends here. I build pictures, set the scenes, and create mazes in your mind. He takes a careful sip of his drink. I'm also the last person in the world to know the lost words of Kra. He closes his eyes tightly, and when he opens them again, you see worms of light dancing in his eyes. They're gone again with the next blink. They're a weaponized meme, a thought that sticks in your head, a tune you can't get rid of, a saying that echoes in your mind until it drives you mad and melts your brain. Ziobe lays a hand on his arm. You don't have to talk about this, Theboros. She turns to you. It's eating away at him. He has it compartmentalized, but he says that he can feel it burning away at his mind. I feel the power in you. Can you help him? Alright, guys, hold on a second. Alright, tell me about yourself again. Word warrior. Language my specialty. Constructing dreamscapes and impenetrable logic puzzles for the discerning villain of the story. That would be, of course, anyone who stands against our motley band of heroes. Because, after all, aren't we all heroes to ourselves? He briefly tips his hat. Though admittedly, not everyone would see it that way. I can't believe we're talking about a meme. What are you going to do about the weaponized meme that's burning your mind? I guess this is where the interwebs is heading to, memes that are actually weapons. Well, I could always kill myself. Honestly, I don't think anyone else could carry it, and the alternatives are too horrific to bear. He tilts his glass toward them. I love my colleagues here, but can they handle the words of Kra? I don't think so. Right now I've got them locked into a mental construct no one has even the slightest idea how to build. Oh, I gotta tell them that. You should release the word. Unburden yourself. Are you seriously suggested that I unleash a civilization-destroying word? Because I'm tired? Oh, no. I don't want to tell him yes. He stares at you for a moment. No, not really. Yeah, I didn't want to tell him yes, and the only option is no, it's a joke. I would have liked an option that no, didn't realize what I was saying. I do have a space in my mind, and I can contain the words of Kra there. He leans back and crosses his arms. Really? And how is it that you are a better custodian for the words of Kra than I am? I'm more than strong enough. Use your psychic ability to read me. I'm not going to go all out on this. I'm not sure if I want to contain the words of Kra. He focuses on you, and you feel something like the skittering of spiders across your mind. They plunge inside, and suddenly you sense his presence in the labyrinth, and you can feel his mind recoil. No. No. I don't think so. It's not just your mind in there. Many minds share that space, and honestly, I just don't trust that you'll guard the word. That's actually fine, because I don't want a weaponized meme inside me. I don't actually have a solution right now, but I do have more questions. Figures. What do you want to know? What can you tell me about the adversaries? His eyes narrow, and he leans in close. I don't want to talk them up. It's important to understand that they are not unbeatable, that they are not immortal. They're tough, hells yes, but they can be stopped. He leans back. That said, what are they? You've heard of spirits, beings of pure thought. That's what they are, except that they're more like living hate, like every nightmare of fear that you can't escape, a vortex of despair. And that's why we fight, because they're poison. Monstrously strong beings of the darkest emotions we've ever experienced. They exist only to devour. What can you tell me about the words of Kra? His long face grows more somber, if that's possible. Those words were the ruin of an ancient civilization. I had this story from a dying Nevigen before I wrested the last word from its mind. Goes like this. The Skylarks of that age had found deep truths about the world, and they stumbled across these words. They wrote the knowledge down and sealed the words away with the strongest warnings they could find, and then they killed themselves so they wouldn't infect their kind. The problem was they didn't count on their writing sticking through the ages. Some skist-brained fool ignored the warnings on the bindings, read the words, and spilled them out into the civilization that had grown up in that spot over the millennia. 8 rulers of Kra, 8 words, and a continent-spanning empire fell, its people bleeding from their eyes with hatred in their hearts. Survivors tried the scholar who had released the words, buried him in stone. The words were lost again. A Nevigen, a hero, found the imprisoned scholar. He tried to wipe away the knowledge he'd spoken and remove him from the world. Had the Nevigen stuck there, it would have sent the dust itself, rewriting the words of Kra on the floor in the wind. He bows his head. But it was too late. The words had infested his mind. I found the words. I burned them from the world, trapped them in a maze in my mind, and they're near the exit. Can't tell you much more than I already have. Even talking about a weaponized meme is dangerous. Brings it closer to the surface, you know. Like when you get a tune stuck in your head, but you can't stop humming it. Can't stop. He snaps his mouth shut and rolls his eyes back into his head. Sweat beads on his brow. At last he releases his breath in an explosive gasp. Almost got away from me there. Measures and countermeasures work. What's that? Rational thinking, but it's... He rubs his eyes. Hard. What can you tell me about this place? Ask Dhama. Ask Leto. Ask Ziobe or Feriak. I just drink here. He considers, I don't think I told you anything the first time, so no. Can you tell me any stories about the others in this bar? I can, but I won't. Talk to them yourself. They all have a piece of wisdom that they carry in themselves, and I won't dishonor them by telling their stories for them. He scratches under the brim of his hat. I can eulogize them, but every story would start like, here's a warrior, selfless and self-absorbed, knowing about themselves they can help the world. But they're all more than that. See if you can get him from a different perspective than me. Clarion needs strong allies to fight in the endless battle. Would you be willing to join her?
Making a note.
Not while Dhamma's convinced that one of the adversaries still lives, no. Besides, I've got other concerns. Maybe later. Okay. And to you, I suppose. Thanks. Alright, Ziobe. You're up. You're next. This woman's face seems timeless, neither old nor young, unblemished but somehow not perfect. Her dark and wavy hair floats like a cloud to her shoulders. When she speaks, her voice is musical, almost artificial. I'm Ziobe, and you are... She concentrates, fingers pressed to her temples. When her table mates start smiling, she pulls them away. I'm not actually a mind reader like these two. Just a joker. Huh. So you have no mental powers? Oh, I do, but they extend in other directions. She cocks an eyebrow, and her glass rises from the table to her mouth. She sips daintily, and the glass descends to the table. Tell me, are you from the area? A small hamlet? Slightly isolated, but still within the broader Sagus Protectorate? Somewhere near Arvin Wood, perhaps? I actually don't know where I'm from. I was born in a falling star. What? How is it that you know the language here? You must be particularly observant. Your voice, your inflections, your mannerisms, they speak of someone whose upbringing was based on an older version of the Sagus Cliffs dialect. That suggests an isolated aldea or an enclave of some sort. Although she claimed not to be a mind reader, Ziobe's mind is impenetrable. She might as well be one of the bartender's pumps. Can you tell me more about yourself? I am Ziobe. Ziobe. I hail from the western reaches of the Clock of Kala, near Methunis. She bows her head modestly. I have had the opportunity to serve with my fellows here in a number of disturbances, though if you wish to hear more about those conflicts, you must speak with Dhama. I am their support, their backup, and if need be, their physical offense. I am what you might call the blaster for our group of veterans, the one who takes care of the physical business once my colleagues have worn down our foe's mental defenses. What's going on with this place? It's the Fifth Eye. It's where the psychics and psionics of Sagus Cliffs have been coming for generations to protect ourselves from the noise of the city. Life is easier when you are among friendly people, those of your own kind. Though not everyone here is technically one of us. Some of the people you see here are manifestations of our minds. Some of them were called here by our minds. Some have come from other dimensions, even. She leans back, tapping a finger on her lips. I have a challenge for you. One of the five of us who own this bar is a projection. Talk to the other veterans of the Psychic Wars and see if you can figure out which of us is the projection. You can ask each of us only once, so make your questioning count. Huh. Are you the psychic projection? Me? No. No. Indeed. In fact, I am projecting him now. It's my power that makes the projection possible. If I were you, I'd focus on... physicality. Best of luck. I'm looking for warriors to join the endless battle. Clarion would be honored to call you an ally.
I'll remember that.
I am through with war. Finished. I want nothing more to do with conflict. I have served my time. My colleagues might help you, but I refuse. Don't ask again. Okay, may the wind carry you. Ziobe says one of you veterans is a psychic projection. Is it you? A psychic projection. That's an interesting way to word it, Z. He tilts his head towards Ziobe. Couldn't you say that we're all psychic projections in one way or another? He leans in. Put it this way. Are you always how I picture you? Does your behavior change based on my thoughts? No. Your thoughts are your own, as are your opinions. They have nothing to do with me. Ooh, red tide, huh? Heh. So if you hear that I've been telling people that you're a Tolki runoff and your body's full of skist, and I'm of a mind to cut you open to prove it, you don't change your behavior? Keep in mind I've done nothing to you in this example. Not one damn thing. At least not in this physical realm, but I've affected you anyway, purely with the power of my thoughts and my words. He taps his head with a gnarled finger. We might as well say that we're all interconnected at a fundamental level, that our thoughts and actions have effects on each other. It might not be reality, that is the truth, but we each have a perception of a truth. It's a guiding star that we use to live our lives. It's not reality for everyone, but it's reality for us. It's our story. Dhama rolls his eyes. Oh no, Ziobe. Theboros is getting started again. Hush you, I'm lecturing. He turns back to you. Even if we don't understand reality, we understand stories. So maybe our best gauge for how we experience each other is through the stories we know and the words we use when we tell those stories. He laughs. What I'm really telling you is that I'm not Ziobe's projection. Maybe learn some of our tales and you get to the truth. A truth, anyway. Alright, let's ask them if they're projection, Leto. Are you the projection, or are you real? Who can say what reality is? I see strands of possibility tying the future and the past together. Probabilities grow and decrease. Is a small probability a reality? In one universe it will be. In another it has vanished into the web of might-have-beens. An opportunity for nostalgia or gratitude at avoiding it. I will tell you that reality is more than our perception of time. It exists beyond us. What is in the past extends into the future. Touch the threads of the past and you can see their intended shape. Know what it is that you seek and you will be able to discern your reality. Ferioc says, huh, what are you even saying, Leto? A smile touches her lips. Only that one who would question reality must know how that reality should behave. She faces you more fully. I am not this projection you seek. Well, is any of them actually going to admit it? Very awkward. Are you the one? He laughs. Now why would I come right out and tell you? If Ziobe's playing a game, why should I spoil her fun? Come on, puzzle it out. But let me offer a clue. Know your subjects. I guess that's the kind of thing an empath would say, eh? Theboros said I should know about people's stories. And what stories do you want to question? I was a group spotter, an empath. Until the adversary burned out that skill. That's basically all you need to know. Ziobe says I should focus on physicality. She did? How's this then? He concentrates momentarily and bottles and glasses circulate in a convoluted pattern around his head. They settle back into place for a moment. How's that for physicality? Leto said that you were an empath, not a telekinetic. Did she now? He looks over at her and frowns. She shrugs. What if I developed telekinesis after the adversary stole my empathic ability? Again? Well, I suppose. I think it might be him, because I can ask him more than once. Sort of. I don't know. I can't ask him about himself. I kind of think it's him. He's got physicality. She's from another time. She's way too complicated. Okay, there's one we haven't talked to. Well, there's a malaise over here. us. This booth was once a metal tank that held some sort of liquid. Alright, let's talk to Dhama of the Bloom. The wispy mustache on this pudgy middle-aged man would be almost comical if it weren't for his deep and despairing eyes. They are the eyes of a man who has passed through the gates of alien hells and returned, though not necessarily whole. His fingers, tightly wrapped around some fine glassware, are strong and slim. A musician's fingers, or a strangler's. You can't read his thoughts at all. You might as well try to read the thoughts of a wall. Before you open your mouth to speak, he says, "What is that place in your head?" It's a labyrinth. A labyrinth? He raises an eyebrow and leans back in his seat. That's a novel construction. He starts ticking items off on his fingers. I've seen people construct psychic fortresses, cathedrals, graveyards, hellscapes, and vortices from which no life escapes. All dramatic places, all powerful and forbidding. But a labyrinth? That's a whole different construction. That speaks to cunning and guile. Do you mind if I take a quick look? Seems like a strange thing to carry and not know anything about. His voice is polished and clean. Friendly, but intent. I guess maybe we'll learn something. Go ahead. My thanks, though it's not often the wisest choice to let strangers enter your mind. I'll not do you any harm. Might help, even. He smiles to take the sting out of his words. Ready? He breathes in, and suddenly you feel... You are a moat tucked inside a gigantic prism, with eyes peering in at you from all around. You are held tightly in an enormous fist. You are a flimsy piece of glass held up to the light. Yet somehow it is not utterly terrifying. His words come to you as if from a distance. A shared space? Such depths. Such twists. It builds itself around your experiences, around those who share it with you. Shared spaces are occasionally dangerous, so I sharpened a part of your mind. His voice draws closer, and the pressure eases. I didn't probe deeply, but this would be an excellent battleground. If you lured a foe to you, you could trap it within your mind. You could destroy it. Oh, introductions. Yes. Cool. I gained another intellect, and my intellect pool is now 12. Awesome. But these are not going up, unfortunately. I have to rest first. He sets the glass down and shakes your head. I'm Dhama. Dhama of the Bloom. Yes, I know. He pinches the bridge of his nose, his eyes tightly shut, and you feel a gentle and powerful presence surround your consciousness. I have a request for you. It might seem strange, but you have an interesting topography to your mind. You might be able to help us. Drink. Oh, my throat's getting sore. The fifth eye is home to psychic veterans. We fought an incursion of nightmares, I suppose. Nightmares slithering into the city's shared dream space, eating minds and leaving husks behind. We called them the adversaries. We burned them out and cauterized the wounds through which they infected our reality. But I can't shake the nagging feeling that one of them survived and waits to strike. I trust my intuition, and now it's telling me to ask for your help. I'd be happy to help. What do I need to do?
Making a note.
He breathes a sigh of relief. My thanks. I feel the adversary. I know it's here. I know it's close. It's watching us. But it's hiding its presence, and I fear it will strike when our guard is down. It may well be in the fifth eye even now. He shrugs helplessly. Oh, is it this thing? Sadly, our fifth eye is blind. He jerks a thumb at the bartender. It might be that our foe has blinded us, but it might not have shielded itself from you. Look for it, and tell me if you find anything unusual. Or something unusual. And I got a lot of questions. Tell me about yourself. I told you they call me Of the Bloom. I was born there, and I knew nothing of the world outside for the longest time. I thought it was normal to play in passages made of gut and tissue, to hide from slavers in diverticula, to watch visitants staggering in from other worlds. I learned how to read people there, and how to understand them. And one day I left the Bloom and came to Sega's Cliffs, and I discovered that the world was a different place than I thought. A better place. That's when I learned to fight. That's why I learned to fight. He gestures at himself. This isn't a warrior's body, of course. Not in the usual sense. He smiles, and a great pressure swells in your head and vanishes before you can even register alarm. But I'm not usual. No one in the Fethi is. We're psychics, psionics, seers. Call us mind-benders or thought-rippers. But we're warriors. We keep the minds of Sagus Cliffs safe from threats they don't even imagine. Theboros growls. They'd go crazy if they did. Not that they're exactly paragons of sanity at the best of times. You can feel his gentle amusement tinged with sadness as his mind touches yours. I am Dhama, the leader of these fine warriors. They look to me for inspiration. Laughter ripples from his gathered companions. Strength, anyway. I help them, lift them, guide them where I can. You can feel the steel in his thoughts now. I am a locus. I am the edge of the sword. What is this place? This is the Fifth Eye. You might think of it as a retirement home or a veterans hospital, but it wasn't always this way. Look around you. He gestures at the pipes and the disused machinery. There's a reason we're here. Ask your questions.